was looking at this list of greatest singers of all time on the internet. I'm looking at, going down, 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 more and more, 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 more. It's like, no George Jones. I say, are you kidding me? I was wondering if they made like a list of the greatest saints in history or spiritual influences in history. I think I've seen those lists, actually. And it's like, where is Padmasambhava? Come on. I mean, what? Right? They got Moses in there, Elijah. That's good. That's fine. That's all good. They got, you know, but Padmasambhava, hello? I think something like some magazine list, you know, the 10 greatest spiritual influences in history, influences. And I don't remember Padmasambhava showing up too highly. It's like, wow. So sometimes the real top-notch ones, they get overlooked. Padmasambhava's story today. I'll tell you what happened. I actually checked into Facebook. I haven't been checking in there for number of weeks, actually. And Lhotsawa House. Lhotsawa means a translator in Tibetan. It's a translation. It's a house that translates classic great Tibetan texts. It's a wonderful, wonderful website. Lhotsawa House. And they had this the wish-fulfilling tree, which is the history of Padmasambhava, which was revealed as a terma treasure by some Tibetan Tirtan who finds these terma treasures that Padmasambhava set aside for future generations. And this was his history. And I read that, and it was just like, wow, so extraordinary, so extraordinary. I never heard anything like it. It really was astonishing. So I'm then driving to the store, and suddenly I'm just hit with this feeling, like, you know, because Padmasambhava says, call upon me, please call upon me. I will help you. And so I called upon him, and I really felt great in doing so. Yeah, it's just, I just felt great. I just said, wow, I just feel like this is connecting somehow, this plea for help. Padmasambhava, we need help. So I finished the prayer, and resonating with it, I say, okay, wow. And then I look over, and something catches my eye in the passenger's, outside the passenger window. As I just park, and what I see is a Superman shirt. And this guy had just gotten out of the car, just pulled in next to me, got out of the car, and he had a Superman shirt on, and he walked into the store. I just said, wow, that's perfect. I called upon Padmasambhava, and a guy in a Superman shirt shows up immediately. And this is the trademark of Padmasambhava and his lineage, you might say, which is really the Nyingma lineage, which is, and Longchenpa is the one that codified Padmasambhava's teachings perfectly, you know, the highest explanation codification. He put it all together. And so that lineage, the Nyingma master lineage, I have to say, they're astonishing in the rapidity of their response to our petitions to them. It's just like they're just waiting, and boom! I mean, this was to the second, you know? I'm just like, whoa! Again and again and again, when I make really heartfelt petitions, that they respond within seconds. And I've never experienced that before. This is something that is really astonishing. So, hey, it is what it is. I don't know what to make of it exactly, really, but it's worth trying, you know? Right? I mean, we're in such a bad shape in the world right now. You know, I'm willing to try anything, pretty much. I mean, I'm willing to petition Padmasambhava. You better believe it. You better believe it. And, wow. And this came on the heels of this interesting corollary discussion in my mind about who would I rather play golf with, Jack Nicklaus or Tiger Woods. And I was thinking, you know, Jesus or Padmasambhava, so to speak, kind of thing. Who would I rather play golf with? And my answer is Tiger Woods. It's just, you know, I just would feel more comfortable with playing golf with Tiger Woods. Jack Nicklaus, I never quite warmed up to his personality. He had some sort of a bit of a prickly personality, and a bit of, you know, quite aloof. And Tiger Woods is, but they're different. They're very different personalities. And there's nothing, you know, bad with Jack Nicklaus' personality or anything, but he was sort of like, I just wouldn't feel comfortable playing golf with Jack Nicklaus. But Tiger Woods, I would feel comfortable, and I think he'd feel comfortable playing golf with me too. I really do, because I've met him, and I liked him. There was like a rapport. I felt, oh, I feel comfortable with this vibe. You know, it's not. I feel comfortable. Whereas Nicklaus, I never met Nicklaus, but I certainly watched him his whole career, and I never quite, you know, warmed up to him, and there are a lot of people kind of feel that way, so. Yeah, I'd love to play golf with Tiger Woods. So, you know, just people have this affinity. It just, and you can't, it's hard to describe because, you know, Jack Nicklaus is a wonderful guy. And he's, you know, fabulous. They're both fabulous golfers. I think if you had best two out of three on a U.S. Open course between Tiger Woods and Jack Nicklaus, I think it would be Tiger Woods 2 and Jack Nicklaus 1 in terms of victories. I really do. I think Tiger Woods' skill set is higher. And if you went one-on-one in their prime, I think Tiger Woods would take 2 out of 3. But it would be close, and if it went the other way, you know, it wouldn't be too surprising, right? So it's like that. So it's just, we just have a fit for certain teachers, I guess. If we just feel a little more comfortable. But there's nothing wrong with that. We don't have to explain it. It's just, you know, there's just styles, right? Styles. Just like singers, styles. Maybe some people, you know, just aren't comfortable with country singing George Jones. But for me, it's just like, I just instant, you know, love at first hear. It was just like, oh my gosh. I didn't know who it was when I first heard a couple songs. I was on some compilation of country gospel songs. I listened to this CD over and over and over, must be 100 times or something, and I loved it all. Then some inner voice said to me, who do you like the best? And I said, well, there's a couple songs I think are the best on there. And they said, well, check them out. So I said, I don't know who they're by. And I checked them out, and it said George Jones. I said, who's George Jones? I've never heard of him. And I go, huh, that's interesting. Both the songs I thought were the top notch were both his songs. I didn't even know that. And I said, well, let me get a CD. So I got a CD. I played it. I said, oh my gosh, all the songs are great. I said, and then I went from there. I just discovered all his songs. I said, oh my gosh, this is like an unbelievable treasure. It's like a never-ending treasure chest. But you know, there are not many people like George Jones. If you either love him or you don't know who he is, pretty much. That's basically it. George Jones fans, they love George Jones, period. They don't say, well, I like him. No. I mean, he's just ridiculously good. And so Padmasambhava, you know, Tibetan Buddhists, they love Padmasambhava. They just love Padmasambhava. Because in his memoirs, you know, what he did for Tibet is just astonishing. It was a savage land, a dark and savage land. He subdued the entire land. He spread the Dharma throughout the entire land and made it a shining light to the world. And we are indebted to Padmasambhava. The whole world is. Now, on a slight tangent to this, who knows where this video is going to go? Okay, so just hang in there. There's all sorts of stuff that could be brought up here. Right, and that's what we do. And you know, it's nice to be back in the groove of taping. And I have a dream to tell you about, which is pretty extraordinary. But apropos of Padmasambhava and Tibetan Buddhism, something very important that came up today, and that is, take this perspective that everything is God's grace and it's helping you. You're being helped by everything that happens. It's a great help to you. For example, like the Chinese. Okay, I have an issue with the Chinese, communist Chinese, and their attitude and the way they treat the earth and the environment and other people. You know, and it's, it's like, wow, it's not so cool. And we have an invasion of Chinese right now in the Bay Area. It's where I live, especially Silicon Valley. It's just unbelievable. They're like taking over. 70% of real estate in the Bay Area is sold to Chinese now. And they pay cash. And they outbid everybody else. Just boom, cash on the spot. I'll just beat anybody. And they're just swarming in here. And, you know, I'm like, whoa, you know. And they just go to the front of the line. They don't wait in line. They just cut in line in front of everybody and expect to be served right away like you're some sort of second-class citizen to them. And so this attitude, I just don't like it. But I realized that, you know what? The Chinese, love the Chinese. Because they're giving me a great excuse to get the heck out of this world. Okay. And so what better friend could you possibly have than anyone who makes this world so terrible that you want to get out of here? That is great. That's the best friend possible. Really, one of the best friends possible. And also, the Chinese did everyone an enormous favor by driving the Tibetans out of Tibet. Because that caused the Tibetan diaspora to take place and spread Tibetan Buddhism throughout the world. And I would have never heard of Longchenpa if not for this. I never would have really heard of Padmasambhava. I never would have heard of Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodra. I never would have really tuned into Manjushri. All this very high spiritual teaching, I never would have gotten it if the Chinese hadn't driven the Tibet out of Tibet. So they did everybody a massive favor by doing that. The whole world is indebted to the Chinese invasion and attempted, you know, cultural genocide of Tibet. Great help. And now the Chinese are helping even more, which is kind of a global cultural genocide that they're spreading. And we can say, whoopee, you know, let's have an even greater diaspora. Let's go to a reduced intensity zone realm. As Jesus tells us in A Course in Miracles, he says, you can leave this world, but and not through death, and not through death. He says, you actually can leave this world, directly coming from Jesus, but not through death, okay? But by setting the world free of the purpose that you have given it. Set the world free of your purpose. And then as the world is free, he says, all of God's grace will rush in and return a world to you that is sublimely beautiful and supports you 100% and shines the light of certainty upon you in every which way. And he says, literally, you can leave this world without dying. You can leave this world without dying. That's Jesus Christ. So whoopee for the Chinese. Come on, bring it on. Yeah, drive us out of this world. Thank you. And I'm serious. I really thank them for that. There's nothing worse than that which attracts you to this world. Okay, that's the worst. So we don't live in bad times. We live in the best of times, actually, because there are no times in the history of this world where there's so much motivation to leave this world. These are the very best times ever. So we should be dancing. I'm dancing. Speaking of dancing, we'll get to this dream that I had, which was an extraordinarily important dream. And I recognized and I said, wow, this is really something. In this dream, walking down this road towards where I live, reside, was none other than Mick Jagger of the Rolling Stones. And I saw him, and I said, "Hi, Mick," and he said, "Hi," and you know, he came up to me, and we're talking. And the gist of it was, he wanted to take refuge with me. He wanted to stay in my place with me. And I said, "Well," I said, and I sort of said, "Wow, that's amazing." And I said, "Well, I'll have to, you know, put up with this." My feelings, like, "Well, okay, this is what it's come to, huh?" Now, what does this dream mean? I'm been working on this all day today, and it's pretty doggone clear as far as dreams can be. I was looking up another list, the best frontmen in history, rock and roll history. And Mick Jagger is number 4. I'd put him at number 1, actually. I'd put him at number 1. I'd put at number 2, you'd be pretty surprised about this. I'd put Deborah Harry number 2. Best front. You might even say the best front man is a front woman. But Deborah Harry, I mean, she's right up there, actually. Really, I mean, you could even put her at number 1. But, you know, Mick Jagger. I grew up with Mick Jagger. I liked the Stones better than the Beatles. I was a Rolling Stones fan. Until things got dark, you know, in the late 60s, they it got pretty nasty and pretty dark, and then I kind of just said, wow, you know, that's enough of that. But they were really good. I mean, they were talented, and Mick Jagger is just this, you know, super confident frontman. I mean, he just can't be put down, you know. He's still going strong. I saw a video of him at a recent concert or something, and I could, it's hard to believe he still looks the same, you know. He still moves the same. He's still got it. Are you kidding me? I don't wonder how many blood transfusions he's had, you know. What kind of stuff has he done in clinics in Switzerland? I mean, I don't know how he does it. He's just ridiculous. But I mean, I don't like, you know, his, he's you know, he's a prima donna, and he's very, you know, I don't like what the Stones kind of have become, his persona, etc. But that's besides the point, because this is a dream. And what it is dreams represent your own mind, what's going on in your mind. So for Mick Jagger to show up and come visit me and said, I want to stay with you, that means my frontmanness, okay, has decided that it's time to lay low. It's not a good time to be a front man. Now, I have a very strong front man aspect of my personality, actually. In fact, when I grew up, I wanted to be, you know, the better than Mick Jagger as a front man, you know. I felt I could do it. I could do an even better job. Elvis was a great front man, too. Okay, super great. I mean, yeah, don't overlook Elvis. He was something else. Maybe Elvis should be number 1, the king. But anyway, I have a very strong frontman capability, but it just didn't happen for me, you know, this life, which is great, didn't happen. But I still have that. And so, I mean, I feel like I could get, you know, get up on a stage and just absolutely, you know, just do what Jagger does or whatever, just, you know, just confidence, like, you know, he's just like so confident, it's ridiculous. Nothing can, you know, puncture that bubble of confidence he has, and he's still got it. You know, he just walks out on the stage and it's just like, you know, here comes Mr. Confidence, and he's gonna, you know, prance and strut and wail and leap around and just, you know, this is going to be great. We're just going to put on this awesome show. There's no doubt about it. I don't know. Nothing seems to get to him. So with that, when that aspect of myself is calling it quits, that means it must be really bad. Really bad. That means it's saying, hey, look, it's no time to be a front man right now. The audiences have gone bad. And if, you know, if the quote-unquote Mick Jagger is just saying and calling it quits, you know, and even he says, you know what, this just isn't, this is like Altamont, you know, when they left the stage, this is, he couldn't control Altamont. It's 1969, I think it was in, it was after Woodstock, and maybe the autumn of 1969 was kind of the end of the 60s, ended on this horrible note in Livermore here in the Bay Area, Altamont Speedway. Hell's Angels, you know, got really terrible. And the Stones were playing, and when all the trouble happened, you know. And so, it's like, it's not possible. It's too dangerous to try and be a front man right now. I mean, the Stones walked off the stage, man. He said, it's too dangerous. We got to get out of here. And they quit. They got to get out of here. I believe that's what happened. And they just said, wow, never again. We're not, this is too heavy. This is too heavy for even for us. So when Jagger says, I want to take refuge with you. He's saying, this is, it's too heavy. It's too heavy for me. So the front man energy in me is saying, the world is too heavy. The scene has gotten too heavy. So it's time to lay low. It's time to lay low. So that's why I backed off of Facebook. I mean, I've been trying to push the Dharma out, you know, more and more and more. I wanted the Dharma to shine in the world. I want everybody to realize, you know, their option. You know, it's so important. It's like the cure for everything is right here. I know the cure for everything. So of course you want to share that. But you can't. The scene is too heavy right now. Really bad scene. So that recognition means that frontman energy is coming back and saying, hey, I want to take refuge with spirit. You know, let's hang out, and I don't want to try and push things. So I stopped pushing stuff on Facebook. For the most part, you know, I'm just, you know, we'll see, but I can't push it. I can't push it. I'm just doing this here. You know, have like 45 to 50, you know, loyal viewers here. Thank you very much. It's great. That's really great. It's, you know, most videos I put up get, you know, between 45 and 50 views. Some get even 100. But there seems to be a very steady viewership here. I don't really know who it is, but that's okay. You know, there's someone out there is enjoying these videos. So, you know, there's a very limited audience. And you know, for me, I feel like, wow, I'd be comfortable, you know, with a much, much bigger audience, but it's not the right time for it. It's not the right time. It's not going to happen. So, you know, it's okay. And it's part of the thing. You have to lay low when the time to lay low is here. As Longchenpa said, when things go bad for the Dharma, you need to head to go to the wild woods. No doubt about it. What do I love about Tibetan Buddhists and Padmasambhava and Longchenpa? Well, I really love the awareness they have of the times that they're in and the times that are to come. Padmasambhava was able to see the future so well that he knew when the bad times were coming, and he knew where to hide treasures, Terma treasures, and knew when to reveal them. You know, he had like the future mapped out somehow. And so they're very willing to say, hey, these times are like really dark times, you know, very bad influences, fanatical, extremist attitudes have gained control over the world. And so we understand that the Dharma is going to, you know, have to go underground at this time. And they're very aware of this, which I love that, because it's true. It's true. There are these times. What did he call this cycle that we're in? He called it, you know, some really bad. We're in the time of, you know, extremely dark times. Extremely dark times. And, he, you know, so he's super aware of this. And I very much appreciate this, because I've certainly my whole life been very aware of the trends in this world and how it's trending. And I said, wow, this is going to get terrible. This is the end times. There's no doubt about it. And of course, Jesus also pointed that out in the Bible. He did not point that out in A Course in Miracles, because he makes it very clear that wasn't the point of A Course in Miracles. That was not really part of the curriculum. So he didn't want to get into it. I mean, he says that, you know, just the point of A Course in Miracles, very specific, is healed perception. Okay, right perception, healed perception, which is just to overlook doubt entirely. Just overlook it. Just overlook it. Just look right past it. Overlook it. Look past it. That's the whole point of it. It's not a philosophical treaty or some sort of curriculum of rigid terminology or anything like that. No, he's not trying to structure it out with right terminology. He says, because words are subject to interpretation entirely, right? He says it's not possible to have a universal, you know, theology, really. It's all subject to interpretation. He's going for the experience of healed perception, and that's all he's going for. So he does not talk about the times we live in at all in A Course in Miracles, which is very frustrating for me, because my whole thing is that we have to be aware of the times we live in, and the responses we're getting. Otherwise, doubt is going to hit us really badly. Because it's like, what's wrong with me? So if I wasn't aware of how dark the times are, I might think that I'm all wrong, you know, because so I must be completely wrong, because the responses, etc., are just trying, you know, pushing me like, you're wrong. But I am aware of the times, and this is the spirit of these times, is it's just a profoundly dark time with extreme influences, cosmic influences at play in this world. So because of that, I don't doubt myself. I don't doubt the certainty that I have. But if I wasn't aware of that, I would certainly doubt it. So that's why I think it's so important for people to understand the times we live in. It is so important. I feel that Tibetan Buddhists are very aware of this. I hope they are. I mean, but it seems like I'm out on a limb by saying what I say. But for me, it's very clear. Very clear. It's a savage time. It's a really savage time. And it's been going this way for the last 500 years, actually. And as I said, it's worse than we realize. It's way worse than we realize. I don't want to talk about everything I've seen, but I see more and more and more clearly what's going on. I just said, wow, that is just an absolutely horrendous, crazy time. We're being trained. Humanity is being trained to be slaves of the reptilians, plain and simple. We're being trained to be slaves, and everyone's going along with it, because they're giving us all these treats. You're a nice slave. Here's some technology for you. But we're being trained to be spiritual slaves. You know, and that's just part of how terrible it is, actually. And so, you know, wow. The Draconians, they've been talked about, the Dracos throughout history, you know. The devil, Satan, Lucifer, all this kind of stuff. There's all sorts of terminology, but there is this dimensional entityness of doubt that, you know, is just very prevalent in the cosmos. It's really a troublemaker. And they're here, and they're causing severe troubles, to say the least. Now, Pabasamaba, when he went to Tibet, the place was just absolutely infested with demons and inimical forces. Dimensional entities of all types that were just, you know, very nasty. And he subdued the entire land. And he talked about how, where he subdued the various, you know, bound them all by oaths and cleaned house. He absolutely cleaned house. Now, can he clean house right now? I don't know. It's a global problem now. The entire globe is so severely infested by very forces that are very much into worshiping doubt, enslaving us to the worship of doubt, and posing as if they're the gods of doubt, you know, that we were supposed to worship, and that's our salvation. You know, it's just horrendous. So I wouldn't be surprised if taking refuge from it is the answer at this point. So for me, to my front man saying, okay, and I've been trying to convince my front man persona to say, look, you gotta back off. I've been working at it so diligently for a long time. I said, and so this dream shows, yeah. He finally, I agreed, said, yeah, you're right. I mean, it's time to lay low. It's time to lay low. That's difficult for a front man. The front man's whole thing is confidence, no matter what. They just exude confidence, which is why people love them. That's why people like the bands, the great front man. People just love to feel the confidence. We all do, right? We all love to feel certainty, don't we? That's what we're searching for, certainty, but we're searching for it within the context of doubt, which is absurdity, really. It's absurd. And we don't understand what we're doing wrong. We really are so confused. It's like, we can't turn doubt into certainty. That's impossible. Doubt is doubt. That's what it is. We just have to gently lose interest in it. That's all. We don't even have to set it aside. I don't even like that. It's not gentle enough. You just lose interest in it. You know, it's just that, and it's just it's such a gentle thing. You words don't even describe how gentle it is. Really, it really cannot. It's beyond. It's just beyond gentle. It's gentle gentleness. You know, it's just like you just gently and lovingly lose interest in doubt. That's all. That's it. There's no technique. You just lose interest. Now, you can use skillful means to lose interest, to work on it. But as far as ultimately what happens is there's nothing that happens except you don't have any more interest. It's just like that. It's just you don't feel like doubting anymore. That's all. There's no hatred. There's no denunciation. There's no killing the ego. There's none of this stuff. You forgive yourself. You know, Jesus says forgiveness is the big thing. He uses that term, forgiveness. But for me, I prefer to say you lose interest. And you know, when you lose interest in something, you don't even think about it. You don't even say, well, I forgive you, you know, doubt for what you did to me or something. You don't even think of about it to forgive it. It's just, you forget about it. You lose interest and you forget about it. You're just, your interest, you know, when your interest is really on something, the other stuff you're not even thinking about, right? You're not even, it's doesn't hardly exist as far as your interest goes. So when you're really into certainty, you won't really think about doubt anymore at all. And you won't even think about what happened to it. Or what did I do? Or I didn't. I just lost interest. That's all. So I like to express it this way. I just lost interest in it. Just lose interest in it. So we're just progressively losing interest in doubt. That's all. That's all. And everything we do here helps familiarize us with certainty, and that helps us lose interest in doubt, because we really don't want doubt anymore. It's just our continuity fear is such that it produces, you know, we have a severe bias against certainty because we're familiar with doubt. That's all it is. It's just familiarity. So it doesn't do any good to hate on doubt, because we're still familiar with it. That just puts our attention on it. It's better just to realize that, you know, let's just keep paying attention to certainty. And that's, of course, in miracles, that's what it's saying, is just get used to certainty, and then you'll lose interest in doubt. So Jesus doesn't get into, well, he reads the riot act pretty well in A Course in Miracles. I get a kick out of it. I really do. I mean, he chews out the ego just severely initially. But then in part two, he says, okay, enough of that. Let's now just turn to God and with certainty, and thank God for the salvation that he has for us. And it's for certain we'll receive it. So that's the better way, is to just, but without trying to ignore doubt. You know, it's like, you don't want to try to, you know, like, I've got to defeat doubt. No. Then you're actually keeping it alive, too much alive in your attention, trying to defeat something, right? We're not trying to defeat doubt at all. It's just wow, right? There's no effort to defeat something, overcome something, or anything like that. It's just, we just feel like we're interested in certainty now. That's all. That's just like, so wow. We keep getting more and more certainty, and just wowing it. But we're not trying to apply certainty to doubt. We're not trying to apply it. We're not trying to say, oh, now I've got a weapon against doubt I can use, or something like that. No. We just get used to certainty, to say, oh, I like this. This is so. But we don't like it too much because of our bias. So we just say, wow. Sir, I experience certainty. Wow. And so don't get caught up in this dualisticness, okay? It's just wowness, just one response. Not say, oh, I like certainty more than I like doubt. Don't get caught up in that. So whenever I get certainty, I say, well, I'm not saying yes or no. I'm not choosing between certainty and doubt. I refuse to. I just choose, wow. So for me, this is a brilliant strategy. It really works. It had to have come from the Dharma Kings and the Holy Spirit. I've been working on this for so long. And I said, wow. Refuse to choose. You already saw the clarity. You already felt the love for it. But you're biased, so you don't get in this struggle with your bias. Just say, wow. And you know what? You will love yourself for this approach. You'll say, wow, this approach really works. I love this approach. Because ultimately, it's in the service of certainty to take an approach that really works, right? So you set aside trying to grab a hold of certainty and say, ah, this is it, and doubt, you're out. Because that'll create a backlash. So you postpone that. But you say, look, I know I'll get there. I know I'll get there. But I know I have to be very artful, very skillful in getting there. And I won't get there by trying to put down doubt, trying to defeat it. I won't get there. That'll just cause this dualistic struggle within me. And so, as Jesus puts it, forgiveness. I mean, I guess wow would be another term for forgiveness. I prefer the wow to forgiveness. Forgiveness has got too much of the, I have to forgive you for something you did to me sort of thing. Of course, Jesus makes it very clear. I don't mean that. But wow doesn't have any connotation. Wow doesn't have any connotation. You know, just wow. It's beautiful. I mean, it's just beautiful. What does it mean? It just, wow means wow. And when you can accept this, you'll realize, oh my gosh, you know, there's no struggle in me. When I do this, there's no conflict or struggle. And it's not like I'm forgiving someone for doing something. I'm just, wow. Certainty. I saw certainty and I love it so much. Wow. That's it. And I understand that I'm not blaming myself for doubting. I'm applying compassionate love, you know, to myself, you know, by doing this. But I don't have to struggle with reminding myself that I'm you know, forgiveness. I'm reminding, you know, like I'm not forgiving doubt for what it did to me, or the ego for what it did to me. Nothing did anything to me. Nothing did anything to me. I tried to lay doubt upon myself. I'm the one. You know, nobody, doubt didn't do anything to me. There's nothing to forgive, actually. And Jesus actually points us out, really, there's nothing to forgive. Well, if there's nothing to forgive, you know, at some point you need to go beyond the term forgiveness and just say, wow. Just wow. Is it awesome? No, it's just wow. Is it some triumph? It's just wow. So you just cut off all this dualistic, antagonistic, you know, ideas, concepts, which obviously are put down of where you've been, you know, which is trying to be greater than God by trying to lay doubt upon yourself and thereby God. And you just don't put yourself down at all. Don't put yourself down at all. And there's something within you that really appreciates that, you know, really, our spirit really appreciates this approach. Ram Maharshi, great approach, you know. You didn't feel he was putting you down or putting anything down so much. He says, just find out, you know, where this, you know, I is arising from. Or where this really doubt is arising from. What's the origin of doubt? And then you'll say, oh my gosh, the self, I mean, the I is trying to cast doubt by saying, I am this instead of I. I am I. I'm trying to say, no, I am this instead of I am I. That's just an attempt to cast doubt upon reality, is all. And he says, when you see this clearly, you just, it just stops. So he has a beautiful approach, very compassionate approach. So Jesus had to work with what he had in terms of those he was reaching out to, and they were, you know, still very judgmental. Judge, you know, say, I forgive you for harming me, you know, you're a terrible person, but I forgive you for it, you know, stuff. They're still, you know, Old Testament people are still stuck in that, and so he's had to lead us out of that, but he's very aware of the progressions that take place, perfectly aware, and so he understands that ultimately you get to the point where you realize there's nothing to forgive at all. There's nothing to forgive. It's all me. I mean, I'm the one who did this, and you know, I just did it as a, you know, sort of a, you know, whimsical adventure. And so I don't need to put myself down. And I just have this continuity fear problem. A familiarity bias is all I have. That's all the only problem I have. So let me just gently, you know, lose interest in doubt and be very compassionate with myself, and that it'll happen. So it's just like that. It's so simple. And in Padmasambhava, he talks about all the learning he got, spiritual learning, and how he gave it out to all Tibet and all the stuff. And then he said, then I realized that it was important to give a great boost, final boost. And so, he then brought forth, it's like the ocean where all of this stuff arises from, you know, that this is all subsumed in this great final realization. And then he taught that, which is what Longchenpa ultimately codifies so clearly, is the great Dzogchen teaching that just really is so simple. It, like, all teachings subside within this one realization, and then, as Padmasambhava said, one insight actually settles it all. So he gave out a lot of teachings because he understood that people are still thinking they need to accomplish something to somehow, you know, overcome doubt. But really, we just lose interest in doubt when we see that everything, you know, that there really is, in the moment, there is no doubt. Doubt has never really existed at all. There's never actually been any doubt at all. It's wishful thinking on our part that there will be doubt. We're like, we keep chasing our tail. You know, we keep hoping that there will be doubt. But actually, from the vision of reality, there's never been any doubt at all. So there's no doubt to overcome, but there is bias against certainty to overcome, or familiarity bias. But this isn't any, you know, it's just familiarity. But there's a little jittery, like, wow, I'm not used to this. Like driving a new car. Drive a brand new car, you're like, oh my gosh, you know, I'm not quite used to this car. It might be a really great car, but you're not used to it. Getting that Ferrari, you say, holy cow, I'm kind of shaken. So I did work out yesterday after the taping. Hit it really hard. I might do it again tonight. I mean, I am sore. I am achy. I could hardly move today. Just like, oh my gosh. I'm really putting in some very strenuous workouts because I still want to hit it 360. I got to hit the golf ball 360 yards. Now, I might do it at Kapalua downhill where you hit it far enough and it hits the hill and it'll roll out to 360. I didn't say where I'd do it, 360. But still, you got to hit it pretty hard to hit, even at Kapalua. Plantation is a plantation course. Ben Crenshaw's place there. But yeah, I mean, I want to be able to really, as my golf pro says, smash it off the tee and score like heck. Smash, so that, you know, this is a golf pro. He says, you know, hey, smash it off the tee. That's the way to play. And then your mentality shifts to scoring. But don't have a scoring mentality on the tee, is what he's telling me. Mentality on the tee is you're just going to wail on it. Okay, just wail on it. So I'm moving my mentality to that. And we're moving our mentality, a spiritual mentality, to one insight settles it all. One insight settles it all. There's never been any doubt, which is kind of shocking. Because we expect a whole lot of doubt in our future, don't we? So you see how this rattles our expectations. When we realize there's never been any doubt, they say, well, what about my future? I thought my future was all about defeating doubt. You know, a great spiritual path of defeating doubt. I'm going to be this great spiritual master. And then we see there's never been any doubt to defeat at all. And it's like, wow, you talk about rocking your expectations. So I've already seen that one insight settles it all. And I was like, okay. That's really cool. But full stop in the wow. Wow. It's not cool. It's not uncool. It's just wow. Because I realize, wow, this is really rattling my expectations. How could it not? How could it not? But that's like smashing it off the tee. You know, one insight settles it all. That's saying, okay, I'm just going to keep smashing off the tee. That's my strategy. So that's my strategy right now. And, you know, if you can kind of gravitate and migrate to that, I believe this is the right approach for these times. Don't take a complex strategy at this time. Keep it real, real simple right now. Really simple. So this is a strength I have, is I'm able to really just focus and keep it super simple. Super simple. Just wow. It's the only response. One insight settles it all. There's never been any doubt. Okay, and then block the panic by realizing your expectations just melt down. You think, oh my God, you know, where's my future? It disappeared, you know. Wow, my future is just wow. It's not doubt, it's wow. Wow is wow. And block the panic that way, and then you get more and more used to it, more and more calm about, you know, one insight sells it all. So you see how, the golf thing parallels the spiritual thing. I'm able to see that. And I finally met this golf pro and, you know, got advice from him, which is really cool. And that advice stuck with me. Smash it off the tee and score like heck. So score like heck means, you know, I guess, have a really strong presence of peace in the world, or something, you know, say something. Or it could mean, wow, full stop in the wow. I mean, block the panic. Be really good at blocking the panic. Be really good at blocking the panic. And this will really get us there. It'll really get us there. This is my feeling about it. This is what Longchenpa advises to those who really have the right capacity. That's why he showed up for me when I petitioned for help, open-ended petition to anyone. I didn't know who had responded. I didn't know who Longchenpa was. He responded, so he must say, hey, I'm going to push this, you know, one insight settles it all with you, and you're capable of doing it, so let's do it. So I said, well, I'll give it a try. And I'm still giving it a try. And I'm seeing the wisdom of this approach right now. It's so chaotic. It's so tough in the world. You do not want to be floundering in the white water of all sorts of turbulence, you know. You just want to have a very clear approach, super simple, clear approach, and that's it. That's it. And don't get into anything else. So that's why, you know, I've backed away from the world. Everybody's throwing out all sorts of hope. You know, like, maybe this teacher, maybe this approach. And there's like millions of them. You know, it just goes on and on and on and on. And for me, I already know the approach. I know my approach. That's it. I'm not interested in any other approach at all right now. One insight settles it all. No doubt. There's never been any doubt at all. And block the panic. Wow, that recognition. Block the panic. And you get more and more used to it. And this will... eventuate in abidance. It will eventuate in abidance. So we have the spirit of abidance here more and more and more of just this very simple approach. You know, and I just recommend it super, super highly. What else can I say? You know, I've tried doing a song and dance. You know, it is not a time. People don't want a song and dance anymore. You know, they're just like, ah, they're in a bad mood. Everyone's in a bad mood. A lot of troubles have come up. You know, it's just been pretty much nonstop. I call it the turnover times. And it started in June. The end of June, I believe, last year, when my first cousin, the head of the clan of really all of the relatives, she was the oldest and the most dominant and accomplished and successful in everything. She was really the head of the extended clan, our family clan. She died in a rollover. Her Suburban rolled over on a highway in, I think it might have been Utah, and she died. Brain injuries. And it was just so shocking. We were all so shocked. We thought she was indestructible. So it started there, and that was the key that I'd been given like about 15 years prior to that of this turnover in the desert. I came across this terrible accident. I came across and someone had turned over their Volkswagen had rolled a Volkswagen. It was horrible accident. And this was called, it was referred to as the turnover times. And I realized that, uh-oh, it's coming. It's coming. And the look for a turnover to realize this is the start of the turnover time. So my cousin died in a turnover accident, you know, like that. I said, wow, this is it. This is what I was told to look for. And it really hit home. It was so tragic. And since then, it's just been very, very tough. One thing after the other after the other. Everyone is floundering right now, okay? And we're checking out groceries. And yesterday, and someone's talking about something, and said, and it sounds like that an accident. I said, what happened? So just yesterday, or day before yesterday, drunk driver just T-boned me, you know, just missed, thank God they missed the driver's door. You know, they just missed it somehow. And I said, well, you're blessed. He said, yeah, definitely blessed. Totaled their car. A week ago, our car got totaled, okay? A distracted young driver, teenage driver, on their smartphone, no doubt. Never saw the car, just smashed into it full speed, you know, totaled it. People are getting cancer, people are dying. It's every day, you know, I get something else, you know, and businesses are floundering, you know, people are losing their temper. It's like, wow. And it's like just normal, just kind of getting used to it, say, you know, it's a time of extreme turmoil. But people are not in the mood for the Dharma, for the simplicity of the Dharma. They think, no, things are so complex. You know, we need some great demagogic leader who can, you know, handle all the complexity of it, you know, and stuff like this. But then they're all agitated about that, you know, and they're just, it's this time of agitation and turmoil in the world. And I'm not into that at all. I'm into the super simplicity and just this, you know, this front man confidence and certainty. Super simple, super effective in experiencing this, just, to, you know, working on and experiencing, and that's it. There's not, really nothing else, as Ramana said. Your only purpose in life, you were born into this life, your only purpose is to turn within and realize the self. You don't have any other purpose here. You don't have. That's the only purpose you have here. That's it. So just do that. Do just that. Maybe I'll be a front man sometime. It's likely. You know, it's likely ultimately at some point maybe, you know, I'll be sort of that front man type. And but not now. Not now. It's crazy out there. It's really crazy out there. Really crazy out there. It's really good to have like a refuge place. And I feel this YouTube channel is like a refuge place. Just like the intensive on Facebook, the private intensive, that I did, and you know, I may extend it. Actually, I found that going back to Facebook, I said, oh my gosh, it's the term, I feel it's horrible. But then I went to the intensive page, I felt immediately safe. I said, oh, I feel so safe here. I feel so safe. This is great. It's like a refuge from Facebook. It's on Facebook, but a refuge from Facebook. And so like this YouTube channel is like a refuge from YouTube. You know, it's something on, so both on Facebook and YouTube, it's like I'm presenting a refuge for the few of us that appreciate it. So there's something I can do. So let's just do it. Yeah, let's just make the most of it. Got a golf club coming. It's coming. It says it's on its way. I said, good. That means it's been shipped. I mean, it's going to get here. I like tracking. I like tracking on Amazon. You can track your package. And you see that someone, you know, literally has received the order, and it's left the facility, and now it's in the, you know, UPS. Once UPS gets their hands on it, you know, you're going to get it. It's going to arrive. So So it's going to arrive. I know that. So that's why I'm working out. I say, oh my gosh, because no more excuses. I'm not giving myself any more excuses. This club is supposed to be really, really, really long and great, great golf club. And, you know, if you can't hit that long, you can't hit any club long, period. It's among the longest clubs, you know, drivers ever made, really. It's just, you know, it's a tremendously well-engineered club. From all the reviews, and everyone's hit it. A lot of golf pros gave the reviews and said, this is a really, 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 really great driver. You know, it's just great. So consider it. I mean, consider this, putting this in your bag. And I said, okay, you know, I mean, no more excuses. So that's why I got to work out. And I can't make it. I can't say, well, my driver, it's old, you know, and it's, you know, it's out of date and just not getting the distance out of it and stuff. No, there's no more excuses. There's no more. So just, you know, working on the core a lot, working on the core. Just keep strengthening the core, strengthen the core, strengthen the core. The core is so important. Prevents injury. It helps prevent injury, the core, strong core. You don't want to be floundering around right now with injury. You know, my knee is better. Last 3 days it's been better. It still hurts, but it's not painful. It's just kind of sore, and it's getting better. I just got to, you know, it's just taking its, you know, sweet time. But last couple of days, tremendous workouts, and it's just, you know, it's sore, but it's okay. So it's, you know, it's headed in the right direction, which is great. So I'll just, you know, try to, you know, smash it off the tee, I guess. And that's my mentality. I want to just have this mentality of when I get up to the tee, I want to feel like I'm just going to try to crush this, just smash this ball, just smash it as far as I can. You know, the problem is, like the golf course, my home course, you can't do that, which is why it's that course is finished. I'm finished with it. The Holy Spirit blocked me from it. Last time I went there, it was closed. And then we asked people about it, and they didn't have a good receptive mood to us at all. I realized, wow, the thrill is gone. I got to change, go to a different course. Because that course, you can't really smash it off the tee, or else you'll get in terrible trouble. So it really makes you, like, back off and try to place it somewhere. And I'm kind of finished with that. I want to have a course where I can just, you know, say, man, I'm just gonna smash this, and you know, if it gets in trouble, that's okay. But I don't want it to go out of bounds. You know, I don't want it to be such a tight course where anything a little bit off course is going to be out of bounds. That's just very, very penalizing. You know, so hopefully I'll find a new home course and actually start playing after. Like, really, it's going towards 2 years of hardly playing golf at all. I needed to, you know, revamp my whole attitude and approach and everything, which I'm working on. You know, I'm working on, you know, fitness. Just, I said, I got to approach golf differently. I've had enough of the way I've been approaching it. And I just have to approach it by just, you know, smashing it off the tee and scoring like heck. That's the approach. And spiritually, it's the same thing. We've been able to get this new approach of just one insight settles it all. That's all we're looking at. And we recognize, we glimpse to see there's never been any doubt. Now, is there any doubt now? No, there's no doubt now, actually, at all. Doubt is wishful thinking for the future. But right now, there's no doubt at all about reality. Reality is real right now. And we can experience this and see right now, all of reality is real right now, so there's no doubt at all. We can see that, glimpse it, and then we wow it. Wow. That's like really smashing it off the tee. And then we wow it. And then we get into, you know, then you get more delicate as far as your approach shots and, you know, putting and stuff. Then you switch over to a very patient, calm, gentle approach to it. You get gentle. So off the tee, you hit it real hard, then the rest, you try to be gentle with your, it's more delicate, approach. You want to be very accurate. So wow is this very gentle, this gentleness. You get the insight, you really push it, and then wow, You very go very gentle with yourself. Be very gentle with yourself like that. Very gentle. But people are not in the mood, you know, for the Dharma these days. They really are not. Holy cow. And it's by design. It's all by design. The reptilian said, hey, everybody, we'll help you worship doubt. You're not worshiping doubt good enough. That's your problem. Everybody in the world said, oh, yeah, wow. We're getting kind of tired of, you know, going to mass and going, you know, doing the things we do. And it's just, you know, it seems like we're getting tired of worshiping doubt. And the reptilians came in and said, no, we'll juice it up for you. We'll sex it up for you. Come on. We'll make it, you know, really cool to worship doubt. And then people of the world said, oh, yeah, our saviors have arrived. Like that. They've been welcomed like saviors. These reptilian-minded, you know, doubters, doubt worshippers. And so they have turned the world towards, you know, Super Bowl mentality, right? It's just turned it into a barbaric, pagan world of doubt worshippers. Along with a lot of other influences that are all also doubt worshippers. So they fight the styles, or which style shall we worship doubt in? You know, and what does the top deity of doubt wear pants or a dress? You know, like that. And they fight over all this kind of stuff. Does an imaginary god of doubt wear pants or a dress? You know, shall we refer to it as god or goddess, or maybe god goddess? You know, sort of a combination, a pantsuit, you know, thing. That's the silliness of what's going on here. You know. How should we worship doubt, and what's the deity of doubt going to look like, and whether we should have a deity of doubt or not have a deity of doubt, or should we just worship doubt straight, or should we have a deity of doubt that helps us worship doubt? You know, that's another big conflict in the world. There's all these big conflicts in the world which are just utterly silly. They have nothing to do with the Dharma. Nothing to do with it. So let's see what Superman does. Bahamasamva, let's see, you know, wow. I just, yeah, let him do his thing. Absolutely. He's did his thing with Tibet quite amazingly, didn't he? I mean, wow, what can you say? There's really nothing you can say. You know, really, it's beyond expression, verbal expression. It's beyond labels, isn't it, really? And our goal is to, of course, abide in certainty, which is, the experience of certainty is beyond labels. There's no point in even trying to label it. Really, there's no point in it. We don't need a label fest. That's doubt loves label fests. Just practice. Don't ask, well, what is, describe certainty. No, you just glimpse it and you'll love it. You realize, this is what I really love. Those who ask questions don't trust the fact that they'll love certainty. They keep thinking, well, I don't know if I love certainty or not. Well, then you haven't glimpsed it yet. So you really can't take the path. The path doesn't start until you glimpse certainty. It doesn't even start. Up to that point, you're just stretching, you know. But you're not running the marathon. So it is, we get a glimpse of certainty. Then immediately we say, oh my gosh, that's my true love right there. Automatically, this arises within you. And at that point on, the questions start ceasing. You know, you just say, wow, what do you mean? I don't need to question certainty. I don't need to doubt certainty. I know that's what I love. I just got to get there. How do I get there? And the question would be, how do I get there? And we already have the answer. So there's no, you know, point in asking any more questions. The answers, we do this practice. We overcome our bias against certainty by evaporating our continuity fear through getting familiar with certainty. And the only way we can do this is block the panic. Because when certainty arises in our awareness, our attention, it melts our expectations for the future down. which are expectations of doubt. So we, and that will cause panic if we try to take action. So we have to be committed to no action, non-action, while we're practicing, and using the wow to block the mind from trying to go into action mode. Okay, don't let the mind go into action mode. It's really simple practice. It is not any more complex than that. You know, people may be waiting and say, where's the complexity? Where's the beef? You know, there's no beef. It's simple. It's nothing but simple. And we don't do all this other complex teaching at all. I'm not interested in it at all, actually. I'm interested in what works and what works fast right now. I'm not interested in a slow boat trip. I'm interested in getting there as fast as we can. Because, boy, every day, whew, oh, here's some news, some not good news about, my goal is January 1st, 2018, I want to be surfing in like Waikiki or surf a wave somewhere. Now, pragmatically, I don't know how I can do that because I can't see without my glasses, but maybe at Waikiki, the waves are so gentle, I can wear my glasses. I don't know. Plus, I got swimmer's ear. I can't get any water in my ears. So pragmatically, it's there's some hurdles there. I'm trying to figure out how the heck I can deal with that swimmer's ear. I can't find any earplugs that block the water. I just bought a new pair today. I'll try them. But water just gets in and it's miserable, and I can't seem to get it out of there. So I'm trying to figure some way, is there some way I can get the water out of my ear, you know? And it's just ridiculous. Both my ears are plugged right now. And I can't see everything without my glasses. My eyesight's getting so bad now, it's terrible. Everything's just a blur. And so how could I even catch a wave or ride it? It's okay. So I don't know. Maybe I could put some goggles over these glasses or get prescription goggles. That's expensive. Or I'm not sure. Contact lenses? So I can at least see a little bit. Maybe I should get contact lenses. That's a thought, you know. But I mean, you lose your contacts in a wipeout, but don't you just close your eyes, right? Just close your eyes and keep them closed until you come up, and maybe, or if you get disposable contacts, if you lose them, well, you just get another pair. So I might try contacts, actually. I might try, so contact lenses and earplugs, and just, you know, if I get water in them, I get water in them. What the heck? So, possible, right? Anyway, I didn't say where I surf, you know, I surf Waikiki, which, you know, is just super gentle, super duper gentle. I could do that right now, I probably, but not surf. I didn't say surf pipeline, but I'm got my eye on it. You know, so when I saw the coral reef, they showed the underwater shot with the GoPro, and it was really clear. And I said, "Uh-oh, I don't think so." No wonder why it's like super dangerous place. Kelly Slater said that maybe it's the most dangerous place he's ever surfed, other than Mavericks, which is also really dangerous here in Half Moon Bay, California. It's gnarly. It's reefs and rocks there that, boy, you don't want to wipe out a pipeline, because you're gonna hit the rock. Some top surfer got a brain concussion, a brain injury there recently, and he's really, really bad. So I don't know about pipeline. anyway, the move for surfing to surf is you got to pop up on your board and get your feet, you know, on the board from you're lying down paddling, and then you got to push up with your arms and then pull your feet up underneath you, and so it's you're standing on the board without falling over. I mean, it's, you know, it's not that easy, especially if you're older. As a kids can do it, they're like cats, you know. But anyway, I haven't been able to do that. I mean, I just think I couldn't do it. But like yesterday, I tried. So let me just try this. 'Cause I've been working out so much, and I felt like, you know, I just let me try it. And son of a gun, if I didn't do it, and then I did it again. I said, oh my gosh. So I ended up doing it quite a few times, and I realized, oh, I can actually do this. I can actually go from, you know, paddling, lying on the board, and grab the board with my hands on the rails, and then just, you know, push up like this, and then suddenly just make a quick push and get your legs under, and I can do it in a balanced way. So, really, you know, I'm ready to go surfing, actually. if all things were okay, I guess I could go surfing. I don't have a wetsuit. I didn't spend my little money I had. I didn't spend it on a wetsuit. I don't know. We'll see. Right now, I don't know. It's just hard to know what the future will bring. But anyway, I'm working on it. So I'm working on that goal of being able to surf January 1st, 2018. And paddling is the one thing. I don't know how to practice paddling. I've tried many things. It's just, you need a cable machine, really, to do that properly, I think. Or some winch. Where you're going like this, like some big winch where you're trying to, you know, pull like this. A cable winch. I was doing a cable winch recently. There's this machine we're using, a genie lift, and had to go like this. And you know, that really kind of gets the muscles. But other than that, I'm not sure. I have to figure something out and practice. Because paddling, like 75 to 80% of surfing is paddling, actually. It really is. The good surfers, they can just do a couple strokes and catch a wave. You know, they position themselves well. They know how to get their board on plane it really quickly. They get the board planing, and just do, you know, they got powerful, real quick strokes, boom, 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 and then boy, they've got the wave like that. That's how you do it. But the ones who can't do that, they struggle. I mean, surf, you can really struggle at surfing. I know, because I did for 8 years, until I actually went to school at University of California, Santa Barbara, where they had a surf break, campus point, point break right there. And so I'd surf early in the morning and then in the afternoon every day. And I did that for, you know, months and months and months. And so I was paddling every single day, like twice a day. And ultimately, I gained the paddling muscles. And that's what turned the tide in my favor, because now I could paddle real fast, get to the right place in the wave real fast, and catch the wave real fast. So I ended up just catching waves just constantly. Whereas before, I couldn't hardly catch any waves at all, because other people just dominated the waves. But when you can really paddle great, then you don't get dominated out there. You can catch your share of waves. You really can. And when a set comes, you can get out there fast, turn around, and show people you're taking this wave. And then you're into the wave real fast and strong, and then they, you know, let you go. If they know you and they see you out there a lot and you're local, then, you know, okay, you got the wave. And it's like that. If you're not a local, they'll drop in on you. They don't care. Say, hey, I'm the local here. This is my wave. But that's how you do it. You know, you have to do it like twice a day to get really strong. Now, why can't we do spiritual practice twice a day to get strong at it? So I'm toying with this, you know. What can I do? What can I do to help out? It'll come. It'll come. I'm trying to. If we can practice like twice a day, yeah, we're gonna get good. By January 1st, we'll all be spiritual surfers. And so, you know, yeah. We'll all be spiritual surfers by that time. Maybe that should be our goal, right? Let's all be spiritual surfers by Jan 1st, 2018. But the only way you do that is every day practice, and quite a bit of practice every day. And if you know that's the secret, then you'll do it. And I knew that paddling was the secret. I finally figured that out. I said, my gosh, it's the only way. Is the, because I was around other people, surfers, who are really great paddlers, and, you know, they just caught every wave and I couldn't catch anything, because they were always quicker. And they didn't tire out. I got tired so quickly. And then after that, I'm just like, floundering out there, and when the sets come in, I couldn't make it, and I get white, you know, they'd hit me, and I get swept in, you know, and just get so exhausted so easily. But these quick paddlers, you know, they never got caught, it seems like. It was easy for them. It was easy. And they'd finish a surf session, they're still full of energy, and they'd go, ah, it's fun. And I'd be on the beach just dead, you know, so I was so wiped out. How many waves did you catch? I didn't catch hardly anything. It's terrible. It's horrible. So, paddling is where it's at, surfing. Yeah, so if I was, like, right now, a real strong paddler, I could surf right now. There's no doubt about it. if my, all things being equal, if my knee, you know, was 100%, I could surf right now, but I don't think I could paddle worth a darn. You know, I get really tired quickly. Because it's a very specific kind of motion, actually. It's hard to... I gotta figure this out somehow. Maybe I'll just get like a one of those plastic pools and fill it up and just get a surfboard or a plank or something and just lie on the plank in the pool and just, you know, practice putting my arms through water like that. I mean, that would work, wouldn't it? Yeah. I'll figure something out. Maybe I'll find a... It would have to be like a pretty deep pool, though. It would have to be like maybe 3 feet or two and a half feet deep or something. But, yeah. What is that? A pool like that? I could make a plank, a board, just lie on the board or something, and then just, you know, practice paddling. Yeah, I'll do something like that. I got to do something. So we have to be inventive, you know, with what we're doing in this next year. And just say, okay, I'll get it done. There's got to be a way to get it done. And then you can make it more difficult by wearing like weights on your wrists, right? Or little dumbbells as you're paddling. You know, that would build the muscles up even better. And then you can paddle long, practice long stroke, really reaching out long stroke. And then, you know, quick burst stroke. And also, you know, there's various paddling techniques. There's the lunging approach. When you're about ready to catch a wave, you look at like Kelly Slater. When the wave comes, he like will like use his core to like sort of lunge into the paddling. He just, you know, and that really just gives you this burst. He does that just a couple quick, as he turns around, he starts to paddle the wave. Then he gives this quick burst where he's really using the core to lunge. And boom. Then he pops up and then he surveys the wave kind of. He surveys it for a moment, like real quick, you know, survey. And then... like a cat, you know, he's on his feet, and he's right into the maneuver that he needs right away. So he assesses right away, okay, what type of maneuver, what am I going to do on this wave? And, you know, has it all figured out in his mind. He makes a very quick assessment. And is immediately into it. Now, that's what you, you know, ultimately want to do. But it starts with that catching the wave early so you can assess the wave, right? The earlier you catch the wave and you realize I'm into it, then you can make a really good assessment of it. Whereas if you're like paddling slow, you're hardly into the wave and it's already breaking, you know, and then you catch the last second, then the takeoff is real steep and you don't have time to assess the wave, and you know, it's trouble. So the faster you can paddle, that burst of speed in paddling is really important in surfing, is that you need a burst of speed. And so you don't want to get tired out there. When you get tired, you lose that speed. And of course, having a strong core helps you, you know, maintain that speed. If your core and it gets tired, you have trouble putting on that burst of speed. So there you go. Obviously, I'm starting to get a little bit of surf knowledge is trickling back in my mind from the old days, and it's, you know, even better now. I realize more now than before. And so we need that burst of spiritual speed right now. We need that burst of spiritual speed, like, oh yeah, one insight settles it all. There is no doubt at all. Right here, right now, there's no doubt at all. I could just keep reinforcing this. This is that burst of speed, you know, to catch the wave of abidance. Catch the wave of abidance. And then assess, okay, what can we do with this? How can we help? Something like that. And I'm sure that in the mind of like Kelly Slater, he's already knows how am I going to get out of this wave? How long am I going to ride it, and how am I going to end the ride? Is this like a barrel ride that gets to a channel, or is this a point break wave that goes for a long ways, or is it a closeout wave like a beach break that is going to close out, or does it get to kind of mush? You know, mushy. It gets gentle at some point. You have to know what the waves you're riding are before you even take off. What kind of waves are they that you're riding? Very important. So a beach break wave, you got to just go for it and make your maneuvers quick, and then just punch out the lip and get off the wave quickly before it closes out, or do a floater off the closeout. You know, have that already really come. I try to do a really great floater off the closeout, or just straighten out after you've made whatever moves you have on the wave. Nice takeoff, really hard turn, carve off the lip, maybe get bare a little bit, and then ride it out straight as it closes out. You have to kind of know what you're going to do ahead of time. That helps a lot, so you don't get caught unawares. A lot of guys these days do aerials, like on closing out. They'll come up the top really hard up at aerials and try to do a 180 or 360, and then try to land a floater on the breaking part of the wave that's breaking, that's closing out. Then just kind of try to drop down into the white water, not fall off. They do that. That's very common now. So what are you going to do with, what kind of wave is it? What are you going to do with it? So when we are practicing like this, we realize, this is like a barrel, it's like pipeline. I mean, the wow, especially if the insight's really strong, if you see clarity, certainty very clearly, then it's like, oh my gosh. So this is like getting barreled at pipeline. And you just hold on, and then you're getting to a channel. Pipeline's a channel wave. There's this really, really nice channel that goes out. It's deep. And so the wave just ends there. It's not shallow enough for the wave to break there. So once you make it through the barrel pipeline, and then the wave's just going to stop, and you've made it. So when we have an insight of clarity, of certainty right in the now, there's no doubt right now, so it's a certainty is right here, right now, then it's like, oh my gosh, my expectations are being shocked like crazy. That's like getting barreled at pipeline. And you just hold on and try to make that barrel. And block that panic, block the panic. Wow. Just go right into it. Wow. So you know what kind of wave it is. It's a real strong barrel, and you're going really fast. And you're not making any maneuvers, really. I mean, it's just got to make it. I don't want to wipe out of the pipeline. Okay. So it's very intense. You see the guys like John Florence. I was watching one of the waves that he caught, nominated for Wave of the Year, and at pipeline. Good Lord. Yeah, he just takes this extremely steep drop, and he makes it. He's like, whoa. Is he going to make the drop? It's so steep. And then the wave is barreling so fast, he just makes this extreme left turn, bottom turn, extremely sharp bottom turn, right into a barrel riding position. And the wave just, covers him up. Just, it's so radical. The drop and then the turn was so radical. And then he makes one section of pipe, and then it pipes again, and it's throwing him. And he's like, again, it got really hairy and steep and sideways, and he's sort of slipping on it, but he pulled into another beautiful position in it and tucked into another pipe on this wave. It was just like, man, you can't hardly ride a wave better than that. You couldn't miss. You got to make the right moves at the right instant and not lose your. It was just really fabulous. That's like a very strong spiritual insight. You realize, holy cow, I just saw there's no doubt right now. And then this is going to be very intense. Very intense, and you better ride that wave of intensity properly, and you better lock into the wow. That's like a riding position. I practice getting barreled, the riding position you need on a surfboard. I practice on the Bosu ball. As you really crouch down, and you practice kind of rocking on the Bosu ball like you're on the waves, like you're losing your, the balance is constantly jittering you, throwing you off balance, and you really crouch down as tight as you can be, so that, the lip. You don't get lipped, hit by the lip and knocked off balance. You got to really crouch low. make yourself real small as possible, and yet you're still, you know, in a position where you can pop up at any moment too. So I practice that on the Bosa ball. I do that almost every day. Well, spiritually, the wow is you got to be like that. You're like in a tube riding position. You get barreled, and you just got to be. You're not doing any maneuvers. You are just locked in. What John Florence and the writers of Pipeline do is they grab. Pipeline is a left breaking wave. So the guys will use their right arm, except the goofy footers are opposite. Those ones that would be facing a wave going left. That's called goofy foot. But for most people, their back would be to the wave as they're going left on the wave. And so they use the right arm. They grab the rail, like the front part of the rail, on the right rail, up towards the front of the board, I believe. And they crouch down. They grab the rail. And then they put their left arm into the face of the wave, actually, like some sort of anchor that keeps them in touch. They know where the wave is, kind of thing, and it sort of steadies them actually from sliding down too far on the wave. Sort of it's a beautiful anchor move they use, and that's the move you got to use. It works. It works. So the wow is like that. You got to anchor yourself in the wow. You're on this board. You're on this. You don't want to wipe out. You don't want to wipe out into what? Panic. Like Pipeline wiping out is like panic. I mean, you'd be slammed off that rocky, reefy bottom there. It's very shallow there. It's scarily shallow, actually. I didn't realize how shallow it was. Oh my gosh. You know, it doesn't seem very deep at all. If like 6 to 8 feet deep, I don't know. It's not very deep. I said, holy cow, those big waves at Pipeline, they're going to slam you into that, into the rocks. And they do. One of the Volcom Pipe Pros happening right now, I think, and somebody, Connor Coffin, got his knee slammed into the reef real bad and just cut it all the way to the kneecap, just made hamburger meat. It was really bad. So it's dangerous. So you don't want to wipe out in the wow, into panic. You don't want to wipe out into panic. So if you liken like the spiritual practice, like what we're doing here, it's like riding Pipeline. If you liken it to surfing, it's like riding Pipeline. I mean, it's the best wave in the world as far as getting, you know, barreled. So hollow and perfect. But it's a dangerous wave in terms of you got to know what you're doing. You have to know how to ride it properly. And yeah, you go really fast on that wave. That's for sure. You get shot out of there at the end like a cannon. I mean, it blows the spray and wind and spray come as it closes, finally closes, that the barrel closes, just, man, it pushes you out of there like a blast you out of there. The wave collapses on itself, the hollow wave collapses on itself, and it compresses all the air and shoots it out. And so, you know, we're like Pipeline pros actually here, doing those who are doing the practice. And so we know how to ride the wave. And sometimes we might wipe out, yeah, that's I mean, last week and a half, I've wiped out a few times, I think, really, into panic. Like I felt like I can't quite pull it together here, kind of wiped out. And that happens to even the best of them. They wipe out sometimes at Pipeline. So, but by applying the wow, you know, we're riding the wave of intensity, the wave of shock. We're riding it properly, and we're not wiping out into panic. So, you know, it's like we found some wave somewhere, like in Indonesia or somewhere, Tasmania or some Madagascar, some remote place kind of, not many people know about, but this really great wave. And it's just, you know, we're riding that. But Pipeline's a good analogy. Yeah, it really is, because it's the most famous wave in the world. So we're like locals at Pipeline and just riding this, you know, riding the wave. The rights at Pipeline are called backdoor, and it doesn't always break as good as the regular left at Pipeline, but sometimes it breaks really nice. So we generate the wave through our willingness to just take no action, except wow, just wow. We're going to wow the what arises and block the panic. And then we get glimpses of clarity, really do, and with certainty, just like, oh gosh, this morning was so intense for me. It was just unbelievable. I'm still wowing it, so I don't want to try to recount what happened. But let's just say massive, massive, massive insight and certainty is just massive. And so our expectations get shocked. We say, oh my gosh, this, I got to ride this right. Then we get in the wow, mental position of wow. And we stay in it until the wave ends. In other words, the intensity ends. The shock intensity ends. And then like, ah, we say, I made it. No panic. And then you go out and ride the next one. That's right. So we're like spiritual surfers here. Our spiritual golfers. In an amazing synchronicity, the new golf club I got is a certain brand. And I look up the brand and say, who's playing that brand? And guess who's an ambassador of that brand of golf club? Guess who's an ambassador? I was just like, oh, are you kidding me? Kelly Slater is an ambassador for that brand of golf club. He's part of that brand's team of promoting that brand of golf club. Kelly Slater, the world's greatest surfer of all time, who's a really good golfer, a super good golfer. I said, great, I'm playing, you know, the same brand as Kelly Slater. That's awesome. I like that. What a synchronicity that is. I had no idea. It just knocked me out when I saw that. Because here we are talking about surfing, the corollary to spiritual practice. And we've been talking about Kelly Slater a lot. And without knowing it, I end up playing the same golf brand he does. Now, of course, he plays the king. He's the king. So he plays the newest one, you know, the best and the newest. And I can't afford that. I got super discount. An older club, you know, super discounted. And he plays, of course, the brand new ones that are always, you know, very, you know, $500-ish type of thing or something. I don't know. But that's okay. He deserves it. He's the big kahuna, you know. I'm just a little kahuna. So it's still in the family, right? Still in the family, brah. Yeah. Still a surfer dude, brah. Yeah. A little golf surfer dude. Hopefully he does spiritual practice, you know. If not, I'll have to show him how. So he can get good at that too. You want the trifecta. Golf, surfing, and spiritual practice. That's a nice trifecta to have. Oh, and of course, music too. You got to do a little music, throw a little music in there, yeah. Vocalization or whatever. But spiritual practice is the important one. If you don't have that one, the other three aren't going to amount to a hill of beans. All right? So, you know, the corollary works just one direction, right? So if you don't have the right premise, you're never going to get the right answer. Doesn't matter how you dress up labels. It doesn't matter. So if you don't do right spiritual practice, it doesn't matter if you're a surfer, a golfer, a singer, a musician. It doesn't matter. You're still going to be non-dharmic, okay? Yeah. You could have the best fitness, the best yoga practice, the best this or this, and so skilled in all this cool stuff. But if you're not doing right spiritual practice, you're just going to be another doubt worshiper, you know? Non-dharmic, plain and simple. But if you do put spiritual practice first in your life, then you're dharmic. And then this other stuff is just accessories. It's just accessories. They're nice accessories, but they're just accessories. And you draw correlations, and you can. So it helps your dharma by always being aware. Oh yeah, I can. Oh yeah, this principle is really important. I can see how it plays out here too, and it plays out this way. And so I use it to remind myself. Smash it off the tee, and then score like heck. I realize, hey, keep this practice really powerful, simple, and powerful, and then the delicate full stop on the wow. So I'm able to draw a corollary. But if you're not practicing spiritually, right, you know, skillful practice, there's no corollary to draw. You won't even know what to draw it to. So the other stuff is not going to be dharmic for you. It's not. Same, you know, nutrition is the same way. I mean, what was my nutrition today? It's very good. And every day, I mean, it's the kale smoothies. I'm staying with it. 3 or 4 or 5 nice leaves of kale, Lacinto kale, in the smoothie every morning, along with a banana and, you know, chocolate protein powder and a bunch of other good stuff. And I'm doing it. I've been doing that for quite some time now. Try to get the kale in there. And it tastes great. I don't have a problem with it at all. Lacinto kale is the answer. So sticking with a, you know, really strong nutrition, workout thing, and just getting everything lifestyle-wise. You know, most people have a lifestyle. Just trying to have some sort of hobbies and things I do, making sure I can relate them to the spiritual practice, you know, all the time, relating it, drawing the corollaries and parallels. And so, oh yeah, this correlates really nicely. Though the golf game, I'm not even interested in playing until I'm on the right course and I have the right fitness and the right clubs. I'm not even interested in playing. It's pretty interesting, right? So spiritually, I'm not really interested in trying to push things out in the world too much now, because, you know, I've got to get it right. It's got to be really strong and the right timing. You know, it has to be the right time. Like, the right golf course means the right time. Corollary there. If it's not the right time, I don't care who you are. You know, it's not going to work well. But if it's the right time, then things are going to go much better, nicely. But when you do have the right time, you want to be able to really, you know, present it in the right way. Just like you get on the right golf course where you want to be able to really, really compress that ball. You want to really put it out there. Feels good, and you feel like, ah, I was made for this course. Tremendous. So, is the club the answer? No. I mean, it never is. It never really is the answer. We know that. But the reviews were, I don't know, just amazing from everyone. Just. I've never heard such great reviews of a club. It's just amazing. So, I mean, it can't be a bad club. It really can't be a bad club. And so, you know, I'm sure it'll be nice. I've had some clubs that I liked in the past. I just couldn't hit them very good. Because I didn't practice enough, and I didn't have strong enough core strength is the problem. I just wasn't all around fit. You know, you just can't use your arms and just, you know, and just your wrists and do it like once a month and think you can really hit a golf ball well. It's too difficult. You'll get tired, you'll get sore, real sore the next day, and you'll get back injuries and everything. You really have to be all around fit, balance from head to toe, agility, balance, flexibility, strength. You have to have all of those from head to toe to really hit the golf ball well, consistently, really. That's why Slater's so good. One of the reasons, I mean, he's so fit, you know, I haven't seen him play golf, but I'm, you know, obviously he's really good. So some really good athletes are good golfers from other sports. They're so fit, they're able to do it. And the pro golfers, they're super fit. I mean, they spend like 4 hours a day in the gym. Yeah, they're just fitness fanatics. It shows. I mean, they can carry the ball in the air over 300 yards. Yeah, it's just amazing. They're like 5'8". They're just absolutely super fit head to toe in every which way. So, if you want to, for me, I say, well, I want to do it right. Well, have to be really fit to do it right. I'm not really worried about the club. I'm more worried about the fitness. you know, if the fitness is there, you know, I'll be able to swing the club hard, you know. And if you swing a really good club hard, you know, you get results. You'll get results. The clubs these days are so much technology to them. You'll get results. So the results will be there. It's just the fitness has to be there. So maybe I'm trying to psych myself up to do more fitness today, which I probably am. Yeah, so that's probably what I'm doing. You got to psych yourself up. Same with spiritual practice. You got to psych yourself up for it. You know, Padmasambhava, coming across Lotsawa House's wish-fulfilling treaty, history of Padmasambhava, psyched me up for this video. You know, man, I got to get into this. You got to find ways to psych yourself into making the effort, right? Absolutely. Just like the Beach Boys psyched me up to sing. I hear this song, I say, I just got to sing. Just got to do it, man. And I just launch into it, and away I go. I've been singing pretty good lately. Last week, my voice returned, and it's like, oh, nice. Singing, I sounded great. It's been a long time. The cold really knocked it out of me. And now my voice is just kind of, you know, it's decent. It's pretty good. Like, I also have good technique. I discovered how to have really good technique singing. So that's there. And, you know, I'll get better. The voice is not always good for some reason. It just isn't. Sometimes it's tired. But overall, you know, just keep trending. Just keep working on that. But psych yourself up for it. Psych yourself up for it. How do you get psyched up to watch these videos, for instance? Ah, I say, I gotta watch this video. Walking together in the wild. I gotta get this, you know, the juice of what we're talking about, to understand the simplicity of it and how we have to do it. I gotta get psyched up. I gotta push for January 1st, 2018. I just gotta make this push. That's all I'm thinking about. January 1st, 2018. I've got to be a spiritual surfer, you know. I got to do it. And just say, I got to psych myself up every day, you know, and just push through the year like that. And you can do it. I did it last year. That's what I did the whole year. I pushed through the entire year of 2016. Every day, I psyched myself up and pushed through it. So it's very doable, actually. And just forget about 2017. 2017 is just your year of you're just going to psych yourself up every day and just stick with this, you know, spiritual practice every day. You're just going to get, you know, by spiritual surfer, man. The paddling muscles, that's it. You just have this very simple goal. Very simple goal. You want to be able to really practice every single day with, you know, with profoundly, clearly, simply, and just be really good at it. This very simple practice we do here. Just be very good at it. Very good at it. And then, you know what? You'll rule the lineup, you know. You'll catch the waves. You'll say, man, I'm a spiritual surfer. No question about it. I can handle this. Then you can handle some bigger waves, you know, at that point. You'll be ready to handle bigger waves. And I never really surfed big waves well, because I couldn't paddle well enough. But, you know, looking back, I wish if things had gone differently, my health wasn't good. A lot of things went wrong. But, I mean, I can see how surfing bigger waves is certainly possible. Absolutely. If you have all the basics down, you know, great paddler, good position, know what the waves are going to do. You've studied the waves. You know the tides. You know what kind of maneuvers you want to make on the wave. All that stuff and how to pop up right and you know, keep your balance, everything. There's no reason why you can't ride big waves. No reason at all. And of course, you know, when you wipe out, it's going to be worse. But, you know, that part of you, you're in really good shape and you know how to handle wipeouts properly. You have to work on that. You can do that too. And, you know, you'd be able to do it. You could ride like, you know, 6 to 10 foot, you know, 6 to 10 foot, I would say. Just, you know, that's intermediate size waves. 10 foot waves, plenty big. Believe me. Now I've ridden them before, but it was too scary. I was too scared. I've ridden like 10 to 12 foot waves, but it may be bigger. I don't know, but 12 foot's big. Let's say 10 to 12 foot. Yeah, I've been out in big waves and ridden them. Yeah, I was pretty doggone scared, to say the least. And I was just like, kind of like, you know, paralyzed like with the fear, because I didn't really know what the heck I was doing. I was just hoping, you know, just showing that I could, you know, be macho enough to do it. But it wasn't pleasant. I didn't enjoy it. It was scary. It was scary. But if you really approach it from the way I'm approaching, like surfing now, and same with the spiritual path, you really approach it in a very intelligent, determined way, there's no reason to fear it. There's no reason to fear it at all. I mean, I look at Mavericks a lot, the waves. They have a lot of film on Mavericks recently. And I just watching how they ride Mavericks, I said, well, you know, it's a scary wave. It's the scariest wave in the world, maybe. You're going to wipe out, probably. But, you know, it's still, you see, okay, this is what the guys are doing. The problem with Mavericks is the drop-in, plain and simple. The wave sucks up so strongly. It's hard to get in, really hard to get into the wave, because it's at an angle where you can't really drop in, and yet the lip will suddenly suck up on you and just pull you up and throw you down. Then you take these horrible falls. It's like falling off a three-story building or something into water. I mean, the wipeouts there are just the worst. So, you know, I wouldn't ride Mavericks. I wouldn't ride Mavericks. It's just I don't care who you are, you're gonna wipe out there really badly. But at least you can see what the people are doing. And it's funny, because like now Mavericks is so popular that whenever it's breaking, there's like 60 people out. Everybody wants to show, you know, how tough they are. You know, I'm a big wave surfer. And it's funny because you see most of the guys out there, the surfers, there's some women out there too, actually. They don't want any part of those waves. They're way over on the shoulder of the waves. And, oh, you know, here's a sail. Okay, let me get on her shoulder. Oh, here comes a wave. And they kind of like are kind of moving over like, you know, like maybe. And you can tell, like, you know, the real chargers are the ones who are real close to the peak. And you can tell they're going to go after this wave. They're going to charge this wave. And so the other ones are like acting like they're charging it too. But they know that one's over closer to the peak. They have the right, you know, to catch the wave. You don't want to interfere with them. So as they're posing like they're trying to catch this wave, then they go pull. They say, "Oh, you've got it." Oh, okay. And then they pull back. You know, that's a classic move. Of course, I've done that many times myself in big waves. You know, they don't want any part of that wave. There's a lot of surfers that go out there. They may not catch any waves at all in Mavericks. They just want to say, "Well, yeah, I was out of that swell," you know. And then maybe they might catch a smaller one or something and wipe out real bad. They say, "Oh man, I got one, but it was like, yeah, it was a really tough wave. It was dropped in. I really ate it bad," you know. And then they can, you know, boast to their friends that, yeah. But no, there's just, you know, the chargers out there. Everybody knows who the chargers are. Some big wave riders are called chargers. They're the ones that get all the waves. They're really good. And the rest of the guys and gals are just out there to, you know, to say that they were out there. and just the fact that there's a big wave at Mavericks and you're paddling for it and you're trying to catch it, believe me, that's going to give you adrenaline rush like you can't believe. Even though, and you know that you're going to pull out and pull back and let the guy, the chargers, the real surfers get the wave. The very fact that in your mind you're acting like, "I might get this wave, I might get it," that's going to cause, I mean, you're just going to be shaking and trembling for the next couple hours. Ah, no question about it. Because when Mavericks is big, those waves are nasty. Yeah. Not to mention the water's freezing. And so, you know, like for us, I keep telling you, like, rehearse like you're going to catch a big wave, like you're going to, like you meet a Dharma king. You're going to meet a Dharma king. Rehearse like you really are like paddling for a Mavericks wave, and it's going to happen. And, oh, it didn't quite happen. But just the fact that you got close to it happening is enough to just shake you up big time. And that's really helpful, because then you allow your nerves to settle, and you get used to allowing your nerves to settle. And eventually, as you get more and more skilled, you know, maybe someday you will catch a Mavericks wave. Yeah, but you have to be very skilled to do that. I don't advise anybody to surf Mavericks unless they're very, very skilled big wave surfers in every facet, including, you know, handling some, you know, horrible wipeouts properly. Really, because you're gonna have one. In other words, the intensity is just going to get really severe. If you meet a Dharma King, the intensity is going to get really severe at some point. So you have to be very skilled in full stop in the wow practice and blocking panic. When you wipe out a Mavericks, you have to block panic. You cannot panic. You have to remain very calm under the water. Count to 10 slowly, you know. Just realize, you know, this is going to be gnarly, you know. This really is. So, and you have to be super fit to handle it. And of course, they have inflation vests now that if things get real bad, they can pop those and take you to the surface. The problem is, if a second wave comes and holds you down, double hold down, that's really scary. And then with your inflation vest inflated, the second wave hits you and it causes you to lose control. It's really bad. It's really bad. You get tossed around even worse with that vest. So you really want to... You got to know what you're doing and be able to hold your breath for even two waves, hold down. Plus, you have safety crew there on jet skis. If they see that someone's getting hit for a second time, they're going to go searching for you. Okay. And they save people from drowning there all the time. Really. So, we practice, but we're out on the shoulder of the wave. Okay. So, our practice is, we're not... you know, really going to see a Dharma King right today. But we can practice like we almost saw the Dharma King today. I almost saw, you know, Padmasambhava today. I was very close to being in touch with Padmasambhava. At some level, I felt I was in touch with Padmasambhava. And that Superman shirt showed up, showed me Padmasambhava heard my prayer. There's no doubt about it. Now that is, you know, extremely intense. That's like paddling for a massive, you know, 35, 40 foot Mavericks wave and like, just about catching it. But, oh, Padmasambhava is riding the wave. Okay, I got to pull out. I don't want to drop in on him. Whew, thank you very much. Oh, there's another set coming in. Oh my gosh, you know, the paddle is like crazy. I'd get caught inside on that one. So, yeah, that was very intense. Very, very intense. So, you know, get out there. Let's get out but fortunately Mavericks has a huge channel. You know, it's a channel wave. It's a slab wave, basically. There's an area of the ocean that's very shallow, but it's just a small sort of area, and then it drops into a deep channel, very deep channel right there. So once you get off the face of the wave and it reaches the channel, you know, you're safe. And that's where all the boats and jet skis, you know, a lot of them just sit right in the channel, real close to the wave, and take video and stuff and watch the surfers. Because there's no waves there. Very nice deep channel, and you get there, you're safe. But the slab, when it breaks, holy cow. And the guys are getting better at surfing it. I mean, if I was really good at the way I'd surf it, if you're really a daredevil, is you'd take off on the other side of the peak or something and just try to get barreled. And people are trying to get barreled at Mavericks now. So the wave riding there is getting better and better. The old chargers, they just kind of go straight and just try not to get killed. But some of the young guys, they're going left and they're getting barreled at Mavericks. And it's like, wow, they're daredevils there, man. They're pushing it. That's really intense. Some of the ways I saw the last Mavericks, like a couple Tuesdays ago, where it was just maybe the best, some of the best conditions ever been seen there. Man, this guy took off on a left and he just got barreled the whole way and he made it. And I just say, man, that guy... You know, his, I don't know, he must be trembling after that wave like you can't believe. That was just amazing. Amazing. I can't remember his name. It's a familiar name, but was it Mark Healy or something? I don't know, but that was just something else. Most people don't even risk that at all. But some guys are going left and risking it. Because if you wipe out going left, you're going to get, might get taken into the rocks there. You know, white water goes into these rocks. You're not going to the channel that in that direction so much so, even though there is a channel ultimately, but the danger from the rocks, it's risky, risky business. And some of the other guys were taken off, you know, so at the peak, so close to the peak, you know, that they were getting barreled at Mavericks too. That's really insane. So, you know, but if you get more and more used to it, and you've got the skill, you could do it. So that'd be like, you know, meeting Pama-Samba or something, going left at Mavericks. You'd actually meet him. I don't know if I could handle meeting Pama-Samba. You know, maybe, I don't know. That would be something. I met him in a dream. Very nice. Great. You know, wow, I liked him. But, you know, eventually, I'm sure I will meet Pavasamba. Yeah, we'll meet the Dharma Kings. Ultimately, we need to keep working at it. We need to keep working at it. You know, you're a Dharma citizen. You'll meet the Dharma Kings for sure. For sure. Maybe in some big conclave or something, a spiritual conclave. But wow, you know, just holy cow. I don't care if there's 5,000 Buddhist monks there. You know, if Padmasambhava was there, I mean, that just, my heart would be in my throat. You know, just like, are you kidding me? But just thinking about that is really, wow, it's really astonishing. Same thing with Jesus Christ. I mean, could I really handle that? You know, I don't think so. I mean, just being honest, you know, you have to be humble about it. I don't think I could handle any of them, Dharma kings. To be realistic about it, it's like, gotta get better, gotta get better. But eventually, yeah, I think eventually, yes. But near term, it would be quite a shock, to say the least. And that's after long, 48 years of preparation. You know, still, so it's getting closer, but still, it would be quite a shock. Because I know their value. I mean, someone doesn't see any value. I know someone. A friend of mine who grew up with Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma spent a lot of time with her, a lot of time with her. But she said, well, when I was a child, and for me, she was just this really nice lady. I didn't know who she was really. And then she said, well, if I only had known who she was, you know. But for her, ignorance was bliss, you know. I didn't realize the value, but I realized the value. You know, so like here's like ultimate value. You know, it's like, wow, that's a whole different story when you realize the value. So the more you realize the value, the tougher it seems. But at least we're talking about this, which is super helpful. At least we're talking about it. So, some great analogies here with golf, with surfing, and you might, you know, have some analogies, correlations of your own, the stuff that you can relate to the spiritual path, really the practice we do, really the spiritual practice we do. I like to say practice rather than path. Path is too vague, you know. So many people say they're on the spiritual path. I'd say, what's your practice? Have you dialed in a practice? And not really, you know. Well, come on. I mean, is that really the spiritual path? You got to have a practice that you're getting. You're determined to get really, really great at this practice. That's the real spiritual path. Is you found your style and you say, okay, I'm committed. I'm going to become just total expert at this practice. and you have faith in that practice that this will be effective for you. It's going to take you all the way, and then you're determined to get really expert at it. That's the spiritual path. That's what the Dharma is. There's other, you know, spiritual path that is not really the Dharma. It's kind of trying to, you know, deify doubt. You know, let's wrap doubt up in a bunch of spiritualization. And maybe that'll make us, we can learn to love doubt. We can never learn to love doubt because we'll still doubt the love that we think we've learned. We'll doubt that. That's the frustration of it, isn't it? You say, I've spent so much effort trying to learn to love doubt, but I doubt my learning, I doubt my love for it, and I doubt that I'll ever get it. So are you happy with that? No, you're full of doubt still. Full of doubt. But with this practice we're doing here, I'm not really full of doubt. I mean, doubt comes and goes, but I feel very certain this is going to work. I know it'll work. I'm certain it'll work. Ultimately, this will work. I'm certain of it. You know, I'm not certain of when it'll work, but I'm certain it will work. So I'm not plagued by the kind of doubt that I had before when I didn't really have a practice that I was, you know, committed to. Then I was plagued by doubt. You know, the path is very ragged and it is terrible. It's no good at all. That's why it's easy to sell, you know, practices to people. So many gurus have done that and become big shots and stuff. But they may not, because people are desperate for you know, to get a hold of at least something they can work on, become an expert at. But, you know, whether those practices really are truly effective to liberate you or not is the question, isn't it? Or this practice, I am very certain that this is going to liberate me. Very certain of it. So there's a difference there. You know, skillful, you know, it's not just means, but skillful means. So it's easy to peddle means, the snake oil of means. But what you're looking for is skillful means, really skillful means. You want to become, you know, top-notch expert. You really want to be top-notch. You have to be top-notch. You got to hang out with the Dharma Kings at some point. So you better, you know, have really super skillful means and be really expert at it and bring yourself to abidance. You got to. And then that's really dharmic when you're focused that way. How are we doing here? Ah, wow. Can you believe it? Hit the 2-hour mark. I'm full of energy for this, you know, full of, I'm really psyched up for it here. It's great. Because I took a nap. I slept in, then I took a nap. So this really gives me some energy to do the taping here in the evening time. Yeah, it's a really rainy day. It's a miserable day. I mean, it's just raining, raining, raining. You can hear it. It's going to rain all night and all the way through tomorrow afternoon, probably. Flash flood warnings. I mean, it's not pouring, but it's going to be a pretty heavy, steady rain. We could get a couple inches when all said and done with this storm here, and you know, it's a wet, rainy time, and it's supposed to clear up and by the weekend, but another 4 or 5 days maybe, kind of clear out. But we're going to get a lot of rain, so it was a blah day. I took a rest, which is great, which is good. And when you're practicing right, you can allow yourself a nap. I remember when I didn't have a practice that I was committed to, I never let myself sleep or rest at all, because I said, no, I got to study more, I got to read more books. I had to read, you know, so many books, and I was just looking at thousands of practices. This. What should I do? What should I do? What should I do? But now that I know what I'm doing, I could take an hour's nap. I say, it's okay. Because I know that'll help me bounce back and practice great. I know what I'm going to be practicing. So it just works in your favor all the way around. All the way around. And I'm going to, you know, get ready to go now because it's getting cold. It's chilly. I'm getting a chill here. Ah, I don't know if I should hit the core more. Maybe give it a rest so it recovers as possible. possible, right? Maybe I can do something. I don't know. Maybe even eat something. Possible too. Hey, maybe one of these days I'll actually eat something. That's an idea. I don't know what I'll eat. Maybe just a cracker with some peanut butter on it. Probably. That's what I'll probably do. Didn't weigh myself this morning, so maybe tomorrow morning I'll go out on the scale and be like, that's pretty good. Hope so, hopefully. Because I didn't really haven't eaten that much yesterday or today. So maybe looking for a good reading, but I doubt it'll be high reading because I'm just not, you know, just not eating so much at all. I don't even know what I ate today. I just had a kale smoothie and then a piece of wheat bread with peanut butter and marmalade on it. That's it. Oh, some walnuts. Yeah, had some walnuts too. Snack on walnuts, which is good. Pecans and some macadamia nuts. There you go. Pecans, walnuts, macadamia nuts as a sort of a lunch snack. There you go. That's my meal. That's my food for the day. All right. So a lot of food for thought here in this video, right? A lot of food for thought. And if you can just digest it and say, okay, to dial it in. And a lot of trends going here. A lot of trends, right? A lot of trends we have going here. So, I can't remember what they all are, and don't try to. Once you've done it, just trust that it's been absorbed by your psyche, your mind, and your mind is in now consideration phase of this and saying, you know, let me just get familiar with what we're dealing with here, and I trust in familiarity is decisive. I keep pushing the, you know, familiarity forward. I can't lose if I keep doing that every day. I can't lose. Bound to be very beneficial. All right. Very great. That is it for this one.